Hi, my name is Emil, founder and CEO of Tomorrow Bio. Today, we're going to talk about what happens to the brain after it has been cryopreserved. So after the whole procedure is done, when people are basically waiting until future technology, hopefully, never a guarantee, advances enough so that the whole procedure of cryopreservation can be reversed, all the diseases that the person might have had can be cured, and until, of course, revival is possible so that the people can live on in the future. The fundamental idea of cryopreservation is always that if the neural structures, so the connections between the neurons and the weights of those connections and the internal parts of those cells in the brain are still around, for all intents and purposes, the patient, the person whose brain that is still around, at least arguably still around in regards to that. It might be possible in the future to revive that person and bring back their memories, their identities, everything that makes them them. And hopefully when they wake up, they would say, well, this has worked great. I'm still around. I still remember how, in quotation marks, my past life was, what I did, who I am, and so on and so on. Now, the initial stages of cryopreservation are always about ensuring that the brain doesn't get any damage, basically, or the least possible amount of damage. In a cryopreservation case, even under ideal circumstances, there's still some amount of damage that needs to be fixed in the future. On average, or even like not great conditions, there's significant damage. But talking about ideal circumstances, the idea here would be that you cool down as quick as possible in the initial stages to not have the neurons basically die. So to cool down, to slow down metabolic activity, which in turn keeps the cells alive for longer. Now, once that procedure is all done, once the cryoprotective agent is perfused into the body, so once all the water in the body has been replaced against this medical grade antifreeze, and finally, once the body has cooled down to, in the end, cryogenic temperatures, which in most cases is somewhere between negative 140 and negative 196 degrees Celsius, what happens to the brain now? Well, at that stage, nothing happens to the brain. Once you are there, once you're at these cryogenic temperatures, there's no metabolic activity, there's almost like atoms are wiggling around maybe a bit, but by and large, nothing happens anymore. And it doesn't really matter if it's now 10 years or 20 years or 30 years or 50 years or 100 years or even 500 years, all of these amounts of time at cryogenic temperatures with a cryoprotective agent in and in a vitrified state. As a quick reminder, this is the state where basically the body goes into a glass-like amorphous state with extremely high viscosities, which basically stops everything from moving. That time, you can, you know, even if it's 500 years in the end, that is totally fine and nothing would change during that time. But getting there are a good amount of changes. Of course, as I said in the beginning, in the procedure of cryopreservation, there is still damage, right? Cryoprotective agents are toxic. If cryoprotective agents don't get perfectly everywhere, there's ice crystal formation, at least to some degree. Of course, we're doing everything to reduce that amount of ice crystal formation as much as possible. But most likely, there's going to be some amount of ice crystal formation if it's not done under perfect circumstances, which of course we strive to, but we always rely a bit on the patient and logistical circumstances to make that the case. Now, the brain, of course, in our case, is the main focus of making sure that all the water is replaced against cryoprotective agent. The brain has something which is called a blood-brain barrier, which basically all the vessels, all the blood vessels in the brain are lined with a specific, you know, special type of, in quotations, membrane that, while the patient is alive, is there to make absolutely sure that no, for example, bacteria or anything that is not supposed to get into the brain can cross from the bloodstream into the brain. So basically, the body protects the brain as much as possible. Now, that blood-brain barrier causes the brain in good conditions to shrink. So in a good cryopreservation condition, with current technology, and I'm going to spend a bit of time discussing how future technology here will work, means that the brain, under good conditions, is shrunken. The reason for that is that these cryoprotective agents draw all out the water from the tissue into the vessels, and then the water is replaced. So the water is all drawn out. Since, due to the fact that the water is gone, it's basically a dehydration effect. Dehydration meaning water goes away, and since the cryoprotective agents are relatively large molecules, they cannot easily cross the blood-brain barrier. So the volume goes down because the water goes away, and it cannot be easily replaced by the cryoprotective agent due to the size of the cryoprotective agent molecules. Not true for all molecules, but some of them are rather big that they cannot easily cross the blood-brain barrier. So if you look at brains of current cryopreservation cases, if they went very well, actually a quality metric, positively meaning good quality, means that the brain is shrunken, the brain is smaller. And if you look in a CT scan, you see that a high concentration of the cryoprotective agent has been reached in all of the brain. So what happens to the brain again? The brain under good conditions currently is shrunken. And in a CT scan, you don't see ice crystal formation, you don't see liquid or any type of water or frozen water, but you see high concentrations of cryoprotective agent everywhere and uniformly. The fact that the brain shrinks is kind of an artifact. It's due to the fact that there's the blood-brain barrier and these cryoprotective agents cannot easily cross it. New cryoprotective agent, and we're one of the organizations who works on that, as some others do as well, under low ischemic conditions, meaning where the brain and the rest of the body has not been exposed to much time without oxygen, where this blood-brain barrier is still active, still intact. In those cases, you would add so-called blood-brain barrier modifiers to the cryoprotective agent. These are basically solutions that open the blood-brain barrier and allow the cryoprotective agents to cross from the blood vessels into the tissue. Now, the goal here would be to don't open the blood-brain barrier too much or too little, but just the right amount. The reason for that is if you open it too little, we're gonna have that shrinking effect again. If we open it too much, then too much of the cryoprotective agent would cross from the vessels into the tissue and might cause swelling and edema, which then stops good perfusion at some other locations. If you open it just the right amount, then basically the same volume of cryoprotective agent would cross from the vessel into the tissue as basically water crosses from the tissue into the blood vessel. So you have an equal volume exchange kind of, meaning the brain doesn't shrink, it doesn't go big, there's no edema, there's no swelling, and you would have, when you look in a CT scan again, would have a brain that is neither shrunken nor swollen, and you do not see any ice crystals, no water ice, but a uniform, basically high concentration of the cryoprotective agent concentration that you want to achieve and not have ice crystals for. In current cases, you see shrunken brains. This again is actually a quality metric. It actually shows good quality preservation. In the future, once you use cryoprotective agent with blood-brain barrier modifiers in them, you would not see that shrinking effect. In all cases, in CT scans, you do not want to see any ice crystals, no ice formation. You want to see high and uniform concentrations of cryoprotective agent. And last but not least, during the storage time, be it, you know, 50 years, 100 years, 200, doesn't matter how long, during that time, nothing happens anymore. There's no degradation, there's no changes, there's no metabolic activity or anything like that in the brain. If you want to learn more about what we do, what other technologies we work on, check out all the other YouTube videos, go to our webpage tomorrow.bio, and of course, as always, feel free to reach out at any point, get in contact with us. We're more than happy to answer all questions you might have in person and discuss with you one-on-one. Talk to you soon. Until then.